If you've watched Decomplexify's database normalization video, you'll probably recall that normalization helps to make a relational database less vulnerable to inconsistent data, data that contradicts itself. Inconsistent data is obviously a bad thing, so you might imagine that as database designers, we should be normalizing all of our tables all of the time. In reality, though, things aren't quite that simple. There are some situations in which a fully normalized table might be impractical or undesirable. By the end of this video, you'll understand what these situations are, and why you might sometimes want to either denormalize a table or avoid normalizing it in the first place. This is Decomplexify, bringing a welcome dose of simplicity to complex topics. Let's first ask ourselves, how does data end up in a relational database? Where does it come from? The database might get its data from what we call a front end, which is a set of screens or web pages that allow users to input information. Another possibility is that the data could come from some other database or databases. Let's focus on this second case, where data from some other database gets interfaced into our database. How we design our database is up to us, but the structure of the other database, the one that we are getting data from, is not in our control, and this presents a problem. What happens if we have to obtain data from a table in another database that is not normalized? Suppose, for example, that we are getting data from the database of an online multiplayer game. One of the tables in the online multiplayer games database tells us about items that players have purchased in the game. Each transaction represents the purchase of some quantity of a particular type of item by a particular player, and at the time of purchase, this particular type of item had a certain unit price. For example, on the 3rd of November 2022, player Elsa26 bought 2 shields at a unit price of 45. In other words, she bought them for a price of 45 per shield in game currency. This, of course, means the total amount she paid for the shields was 90. The price of a shield, or of any other type of item, can change over time. The price of a shield today might be different from the price of a shield yesterday. But let's suppose price changes in the course of a single day aren't possible. In other words, on any given day, one type of item always has just one price. We can express this rule as a dependency. Unit price depends on the combination of purchase date and item type. Because of the dependency of unit price on something that isn't the primary key, namely the combination of purchase date and item type, the table is not in third normal form. And not being in third normal form means there is a risk that contradictory data could creep into the table. For example, there's nothing about the structure of the table that would prevent this from happening. The table is now telling us that on the 16th of November, Greg43 bought a shield for a unit price of 50, while Mark17 bought shields for a unit price of 35. This is a contradiction, because a shield shouldn't be able to have more than one price on a single day. If the makers of the online multiplayer game had normalized their design, it would have looked like this. In this normalized design, unit price has been removed from the item purchase transaction table. Unit price for any transaction can instead be looked up in the item type daily prices table. For example, we can deduce that Elsa26's purchase of a shield on the 3rd of November 2022 was for a unit price of 45, because the item type daily prices table says that a shield had a unit price of 45 on the 3rd of November 2022. But the game's database isn't normalized in this way. It doesn't have an item type daily prices table. And as the game's database doesn't have an item type daily prices table, we can't have an item type daily prices table in our database either. Because if we did, how would we ever be able to load data into it? We wouldn't have any source from which to load it. The lesson here is that you may sometimes come up against an external factor that prevents you from normalizing certain tables in your design. Your ability to normalize your database may be limited by the fact that a table within a data source you're loading from is not normalized. But what if there are no external factors preventing you from normalizing? In that case, is there any reason not to normalize? Let's think about the people who designed the online multiplayer games database. They could have normalized their transaction table if they had wanted to, so why didn't they? To answer this question, let's explore what would have happened if they had normalized the table. As we've seen, the normalized design has the advantage of preventing contradictory answers to the question of what a particular item type's unit price was on a particular day. But the normalized design also has an important disadvantage. We know that at the moment, all players pay the same amount for a given type of item on a given day. For example, a shield has a unit price of 45 for all players on the 3rd of November 2022. But it's quite plausible that at some point in the future, the makers of the game might decide to change how pricing works. What if they introduce volume discounts, where a player pays a lower unit price when buying more than 5 items of a given type at once? Or what if they introduce a policy whereby a player with a premium membership pays lower unit prices than a player with a regular membership? If any of those things happen, the normalized design will become instantly obsolete, and reworking it will be a big headache. The design that isn't normalized, on the other hand, is completely unaffected by any changes to how pricing works. It just records the price that a player actually did pay as part of a particular transaction. The lesson here is that when we come across a non-key attribute that is dependent on another non-key attribute, in other words, a violation of third normal form, we shouldn't always be so quick to eliminate the violation by normalizing the table. Sometimes we may look at the dependency and think to ourselves, this dependency rests on shaky ground. In other words, we'll realize that if certain rules and conventions that apply right now stop applying in the future, the dependency will disappear. And if there is a reasonable chance that such a thing could happen, we probably shouldn't normalize the table, because by not normalizing it, we'll avoid having to change our design if the rules and conventions change. In summary, what we have here is an exception to the general principle that normalizing tables makes a design more flexible. In cases like the one we've just seen, the opposite is true. We increase the flexibility of our design by not normalizing a table. So far, we've been looking at situations where the decision to implement a table that isn't fully normalized arises from practical considerations that have nothing to do with database technology. There are other situations where people might denormalize some aspects of a design because they hope it will make the database platform perform better. More specifically, they hope it will cause certain queries to run faster. We call this denormalization for performance. Why might a person believe that they need to denormalize a table to make certain queries perform well? To what extent is this belief justified? In order to be able to answer these questions, we need an understanding of how relational database technology works at a high level. We can think of any relational database platform as consisting broadly of two layers. For the purposes of this video, we'll call the first layer the logic layer. The logic layer is a sort of abstract world in which we can speak of such things as tables, views, key constraints, queries, and query results. Most of the time, when we interact with the database, we're interacting with the logic layer. From the perspective of a person who queries the database and just wants the right answer to be returned by the logic layer, in the form of query results, the technical steps that the database platform performs under the covers to figure out the answer are of no interest whatsoever. But what about those technical steps that get performed under the covers? Anything technical that happens under the covers belongs to what we're going to call the processing layer. Consider the data in a customer table. Under the covers, the database platform might be storing this customer data in one big file, or in a number of separate files, or in some strange exotic structures that can't be described as files at all. Data might be stored on disk, or in memory. Records might be kept sorted in a particular order, and might be indexed in various ways, and so on. When a query involving the customer table gets run, the processing layer has to access the physically stored data and process it in potentially quite complicated ways before translating the outputs into what the logic layer is expecting, namely query results. Again, quite a lot of the time, exactly what goes on in the processing layer is of no interest to us. But it might start to be of interest to us if we find that some of our queries are running slowly. Then we might start looking for ways to persuade the processing layer to change how it stores and processes the data so as to enable it to run these queries more efficiently. Relational database products do allow us to exercise some control over what goes on in the processing layer. The form this control takes varies from product to product, but it can include things like the creation of indexes, the use of partitioning or sharding, and the running of statistics to help the query optimizer. Describing these concepts is not part of the scope of this video, but the crucial message to take away from all this is that the main layer in which performance problems should ideally be tackled is the processing layer, not the logic layer. When we tweak things in the processing layer, we have the comfort of knowing that none of the tweaking will ever change the results of any query. The tweaking can only change how quickly and efficiently queries run. Looked at from this perspective, responding to a performance problem by denormalizing tables seems bad, because as we know, anytime our design incorporates a table that isn't normalized, we open the door to logical inconsistencies. It would be much better if we could keep everything in the logic layer unchanged and make changes only in the processing layer. With all this in mind, we return to the question, why would a person feel their only option for solving a performance problem is to denormalize? Most likely, the answer is going to involve joins. Let's say we have a table called task and a table called subtask. Here we see a handful of the columns available on these two tables and a handful of rows. Each task can have multiple subtasks associated with it. We see here that task 10548393, which was created by user vtau3 on the 12th of November 2022 at 2:15 p.m. and currently has a status of open, has four subtasks in the subtask table. Let's focus on the column task status code on the task table. We know that every subtask belongs to a task, and every task has a task status code. Therefore, we can say that indirectly, every subtask has a task status code. If we want to know what a subtask's task status code is, we need a query that joins subtask to task on their common column, task ID, and we need the query to select subtask's attributes as well as the task status code from task. If both the task table and the subtask table have many millions of rows, a join query like this could potentially require the processing layer to work quite hard. Suppose the query runs too slowly. We've verified that our query is written properly, and we've made a few tweaks in the processing layer, like creating appropriate indexes. Now the query is somewhat faster, but still not fast enough. We tell ourselves, to really speed things up, we're just going to need to add the task status code column to the subtask table, because that way our query won't need a join at all. But actually, this is not an accurate statement of what we need. What we need has nothing to do with the logic layer. We don't need the task status code to exist on the subtask table, which would make the subtask table denormalized. What we actually need is a change to how data is physically stored by the processing layer. We need the processing layer always to physically store a copy of the subtask data with the task status code tacked onto it. That way, when we run our join query, the processing layer will find it very easy to return an answer. The relevant data will already exist in physical storage in a pre-joined form. Whether you can persuade the processing layer to store data in this way depends on what database product you're using. Some products have this feature and others don't. If you don't have this feature available to you and you've exhausted all other options, then the only remaining way to get the processing layer to physically store task status code alongside the subtask record data is to denormalize the subtask table by adding task status code to it. This, of course, carries the risk of data inconsistencies. Whichever way you achieve it, having task status code physically stored with the subtask records is likely to make for faster queries whenever somebody wants to know the task status code of a subtask. But there is a performance trade-off too. Any query that updates task status codes is likely to become slower, because whenever a task status code on the task table is updated, the update process needs to find all of the associated subtasks in the subtask table and update their task status codes too. As a general rule, when lots of users are constantly updating data in an application during the course of the day, denormalizing the application's database is likely to slow the application down rather than speeding it up. Just one more observation on the task and subtask tables. It's possible to include on the task table a column called number of subtasks. In some vague way, this may feel like denormalization, but it is not. Every attribute in the task table still depends on the key, the whole key, and nothing but the key. The table is still normalized. We have introduced the potential for inconsistency, but if inconsistencies do arise, they won't be inconsistencies among values in the task table. Instead, there'll be inconsistencies between the task table and the subtask table. We've said that denormalizing the database of an application that experiences lots of updates is likely to slow the application down rather than speeding it up. But databases that are accessed by users on a read-only basis are a different story. These databases have the primary purpose of supplying information to users. And modelers of databases like this are more likely to embrace designs that deliberately violate third normal form. An example of this type of design is a data mart which features tables, or in some cases views, which are known as facts and dimensions. A dimension table might look like this. This table, which we are going to assume holds only current data about each branch, is not normalized, as we can see that branch region name is dependent on branch country name, which accounts for why we are told twice that branch country India is in branch region South Asia. Despite not being normalized, structures like this are very useful for supplying information to people in an intuitive way. In conjunction with a sales transaction table that includes a branch key attribute on it, dim branch would make it very easy for us to write a query that breaks down total sales by branch region or by branch country. Also, given the way the dim branch data would typically be physically stored in the processing layer, with branch name and country and region data items stored close together, a query like this is likely to run very efficiently. Data inconsistency in the dim branch table is a risk, but we can minimize the risk by storing the underlying data about branches and countries and so on in a normalized way and loading from this normalized source into the dim branch table. Of course, any bugs or design flaws in these load routines might lead to inconsistent data being loaded, so the load routines themselves would need to be very carefully tested. Alternatively, data marts with facts and dimensions in them could even be implemented using views rather than tables, although it is not always practical to do this. Dim branch in this case would be a view, presenting us with the results of a query over an underlying normalized database. This completes our discussion of denormalization. I hope you found it helpful. If you have any comments or questions on what you've just heard, please go ahead and post them in the comments section below. And if you have any suggestions for other complex topics that you'd like to see explained on Decomplexify, let me know in the comments. Feel free to like, share, and subscribe. So long, and thanks for watching.